Hello, everyone. John Tenney here from WeirdLectures.com and RealmOfTheWeird.com. Driving around once again to answer your Twitter questions. It is not rush hour traffic while I run my errands today. It's a nice, calm Wednesday afternoon with not a lot of people on the street. So let's get right to the questions. Some simple, some not so simple. All appreciate it. The first question is, what's my favorite place in the world? It's actually two questions were asked. What's my favorite place in the world? And how do I take my coffee? My favorite place in the world is my hometown. I live in a city called Royal Oak, Michigan, which is a little suburb of Detroit. It's about 12 miles outside of Detroit. And I was born and raised here. My family has been in this city for about 100 years. And it's really my favorite place. It's just, it's home. The whole city is. It's not just a house or anything like that. It's the people, the environment, the fact that I know all the alleys and back streets. And so, yeah, Royal Oak is my favorite place. Actually, you know, my favorite place is wherever I'm at. I really love and appreciate my hometown. At the same time, though, whenever I go anywhere, like, I'm there. And I kind of dig hanging out with myself. So, you know, that's my favorite place, too. How I take my coffee? I take my coffee like it's a wedding cake. Way too much cream, far too much sugar, very little coffee. Whenever I send someone out to get coffee for me, they always ask how much cream and sugar should I put into it, and my stock answer is always make it taste like a wedding cake. So the next question is, I don't know if they were being serious or psychic or if they knew something, but have I checked my tires lately? And I do actually check my tires a lot. I was, for those of you who do not know, one of my jobs back in the day was I was a school bus driver. And when you drive a school bus, you know, every time you get into the school bus to drive it, you have to go through this like multiple, like it's like a 32 checkpoint system for getting the school bus ready to go out and pick up kids. And I kind of do a really quick version of that every time I get into my car. Like, just check the tires, check for new dings and scratches every once in a while. Plus, my father is a mechanic. He was a mechanic his whole life. And so, you know, checking oil, checking tires, making sure everything sounds right. Right now, my car is having a lot of problems, actually. And I'm kind of waiting to take it to the shop. It's nothing dangerous, I hope. But yes, I have checked my tires lately. Let's stick with the kind of soft questions, which are not the big paranormal questions, and get those out of the way. So I have them, instead of having them written on my hand like I did last week, I have them written on a piece of paper in front of me, kind of, so I just have to look down. Well, I think that's all the softball, not paranormal questions. So to the paranormal questions and the strange questions. Is it possible, the question was asked, that the first moon landing was hoaxed because people have heard that we wanted to get there first? You know, I don't have a problem with the first moon landing being hoaxed. I think that there is, you know, obviously no way to prove it at the time, right now. Even though people say they have evidence, there are some really good-looking photographs from the first moon landing that make it suspicious. You know, there's, you know, if you look at the eagle when it's landed on the moon, look at the pads of the feet. They have these like gold reflectors on the pads of the lunar craft. There's like no dust on them. Nothing. Now we know that the moon is really dusty, like because we've saw other pictures that they've showed us that said this is allegedly the surface of the moon, and the astronauts were like covered with like dust and dirt. But the lunar lander is like spotless clean, and it came down with a huge jet thrust, kicking dust up in every direction that then should be coated in dust. Little things like that make me suspicious. I think that if we did not go to the moon, that first time was when we didn't go. I think that might have been something to keep Russians from beating us to the moon. America was in a pretty tumultuous state at the time because of Vietnam, and, you know, so many people were, there was this anti-American sentiment. And so I think that would have been a good time to fake it. I mean, sure, it's possible. What do... this is not a paranormal question. I didn't see it until just now. What would I say is my ultimate goal that I would like to achieve in the field? And then best advice and worst advice that I've ever got. My ultimate goal is to be a part of the process that helps people to think differently. That's it. I just want people to think more honestly and more deeply, and I want them to question more. I just want to help people. I want to help be a part of the process that makes people think more deeply and honestly about the questions of anomalistic and paranormal phenomena. That's my only goal. What is the best and worst advice I ever got? You know, best and worst is very relative, so the best advice I ever got was to ask the next question. You know, sometimes someone will give you an answer, but there's no stopping point to the answer. Like, you can always keep questioning. So if someone says, like, just as a really quick example, someone will say, there's a ghost in my house, and it's mad at me. And, you know, you can just keep digging into that. You know, the process is actually called chunking, but you can chunk up or you can chunk down. You can chunk down into a real simplistic form to find out what's happening. So you can say, like, okay, the ghost is there and he's mad at you. You know, that's, you're at a baseline level there. And you can start chunking up into higher areas of specificity. So, you know, why is it mad at you? Why would you think it's mad at you? And just keep going and asking the next question. Even when someone has given you the answer, question the answer. So that's the best advice I've ever got. The worst advice I've ever got is, you know, this comes from an older generation, and I've actually heard younger people say this too, but I've had I used to do elder care even further back before I drove a school bus. And there were some people who told me when they found out what I did to just give up. That's the worst advice you can give to anyone about anything, is give up. Sorry, I'm trying to read the questions and see which ones. I bounced all around my list here. How did I get started in the paranormal? I actually didn't get started in the paranormal. I got started in conspiracy theory. I was always interested in weird things. You know, ever since I was a little kid, a lot of people will tell you, this is something that almost is really kind of annoying to me. And I know that it's a real thing for people, but it's, you know, I hear constantly, like, I've been interested in the paranormal since I was 2 or 3 years old. Oh, I've been interested. I had my first I was abducted by aliens when I was 3. My first poltergeist, there's always these stories of, I don't know if it's to create legitimacy to a person's interest, but people always start, like, saying that they were interested in paranormal phenomena when they were, like, 3 years old, or they were talking to spirits and voices when they were 3 years old. You know, there's a level of children's mind that is, it doesn't take into account abstract thinking. It just doesn't happen until a certain age. That's why you know little kids are asked why all the time, is because there's no abstract thought going on. I'm going off my side now. Anyway, it makes me really upset sometimes when people say that they have some kind of, you know, ever since they were born they were interested in paranormal phenomena. I was interested in weird things. I liked to read horror comic books. I liked to read, UFO and alien comic books, but I like to read them just as much as I like to read superhero comic books and any other kind of fantasy. I was introduced into the field of research by a conspiratorial author and researcher who specialized in the Kennedy assassination. I was asked, because of my knowledge in weird things around the same time, which is about 15, to investigate someone's house where they thought that there had been a ghost. But, you know, at that time, I mean, I did a really lightweight investigation, and I had no real idea what I was doing. It's, you know, 1985, I think it was. So there were, you know, how do you figure out what to do? Just the books that I had read at the time, which weren't that many books on paranormal investigations in 1985, and there was no internet, no reality shows to teach you how to do it. So, you know, I applied the research methodologies that I had learned and was learning through the guy who was the conspiratorial researcher. And then I gave lectures on conspiracy theories for years and years. And while I would do that, people would ask me about UFOs. And then people would ask me about Bigfoot and ghosts and all other sorts of manner of strange things. And eventually it just became weird lectures. So that's, you know, a roundabout way to my start in paranormal research. Someone asked if I'm having a good day. That's not a paranormal question. I just saw it now. It's blocked by the stick shift of my steering wheel. Yeah, I always have a good day. Every day that I have is perfect. This is the way the day is supposed to be going, and I love it, and it's perfect, and I'm having a great day. Would I, if asked, ever sit in on another exorcism? Why or why not? Years ago, for those of you who don't know, years ago, about 11 years ago, I was asked to partake in an exorcism. And not an exorcism, not a deliverance, not a... it was a Vatican-sponsored exorcism. There's some things that I can't talk about because of non-disclosure policies and such, but a Vatican-sponsored exorcism as a disinterested third party. I was basically there as an insurance policy to make sure that nothing went wrong and no one was hurt and there was no impropriety during the exorcism. It took me... I'm a fairly well-adjusted person, too. It took me about 8 years to be able to talk about that experience. When you see an exorcism performed on television, you have not seen an exorcism performed on television. That's my personal... I've never seen one. I've never seen anyone try to actually put a real one on television. I'm not saying that people are outright hoaxing and faking you, but I really don't think that networks and producers are so irresponsible as to show you an actual exorcism on television. I just don't think that you would see it. I don't think that the mental process of the general public would be able to handle something like that. It took me 8 years to be able to talk about my experience. I really didn't mention it a lot. It took me that long to internalize and deal with the experience itself. I would actually sit in on another one. The strength that going through that process gave me refortified everything and that I think and everything that is a part of me to where I don't have any kind of fear of the afterworld or the beings that may or may not inhabit it. So yeah, I would sit in on another exorcism. I would help or assist with one. Of course, like I said, though, you know, there are some caveats to that. I'm not going to perform an exorcism when someone calls me and they're like, there's a demon in somebody. People have gone demon crazy. You all know that. You watch the shows. The demonic possession is not a common house. It's not as common as you see on television. That's for ratings and to amp up people's careers in all reality. And the last question that I have here is someone wants some anecdotes, historical, cultural, or paranormal from my hometown of Royal Oak. I will tell some really quick ones, because I'm sure not a lot of people are interested in the hometown of my hometown, my hometown. So, Royal Oak is a city with about 60,000 people. For those of you who don't know, like I said earlier, it's about 12 miles north of Detroit. And a little anecdote. We had the first female letter carrier. That's a historical anecdote. A paranormal story. Something that was really curious is there used to be a little house in Royal Oak where a husband and wife had a daughter who died. She was about, I think she was 9 or 10 when she passed away. And in her bedroom window in the upstairs of their house, they had a life-size doll propped up in the window. And there's nothing paranormal about it, but just weird, man, when people do that stuff. It's just creepy. And it was there for 10 years or more. I remember going past that house when I was 18, and I think it was probably there until I was almost 30. So, I mean, it was just creepy that there was this fully dressed human life-size doll in their dead daughter's bedroom window. Weird story from Royal Oak. Paranormal story. There's a cemetery that is in the middle of our city. It's called St. Mary Cemetery or Old Royal Oak Cemetery, and it's kind of split by two roads on either side, Maine and Rochester. And the Rochester side, there are some graves. The headstones are in the cemetery, but the graves are underneath the ground on the Rochester Road side. So that's just some weird little story there. So there you go. I hope I answered all of it. If not, I'll get to it next time, I guess. I hope I didn't ramble too much. I'll probably edit this one down just a little bit. So if you see any skips, glitches, or pops, or anything like that, it's just I've been stopping a lot, and there's traffic and thinking about my questions and answers. But thanks, and you can follow me on Facebook, facebook.com/weirdlectures. You can go to my website, weirdlectures.com, realmoftheweird.com. You can follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is John E. L. Tenney, or my cat, Paranormal Cat. You can email me, john@weirdlectures.com, and I always like to talk and answer questions, and I appreciate your time. I hope you enjoyed watching this, and I'll see you next week.